So the theme of tonight was like industrial applications, and I wanted to just walk through using the journey of a banana through how data science happens in Maersk and what we do and how we apply data science in Maersk. So in case, I mean, we're in Denmark, so in case you live in a cave or under a rock, then maybe most of you, I think, know who Maersk are. The biggest container shipping company in the world. We transport one in five things probably that you have in your house has been on a Maersk vessel in some way. The shipping is 90% of things I've sort of traveled by container ship, and Maersk have about 20% of that share. So we also have terminals and freight forward company, tugboat company, and we make containers. So what I wanted to ask was, you know, kind of what's a bit different about doing data science in a company like Maersk? And the question is, what's wrong with this picture? And I think most people can tell what's wrong. So Maersk is not the M in GAFAM, right? So in, I didn't know this term, but in France especially, GAFAM is used to describe Google, Amazon, Facebook, Apple, and Microsoft. So yeah, the question is, you know, we're in a 114-year-old company, and it's far from digital, the sort of industry that we're in. So what's it like doing data science there? So, I mean, we're not digital natives as a company. We're far from it. So what are we if we're not digital natives? Well, we're transformers. And that's really what data science is like in a big company. You're helping the company to go through a digital transition where we move from a very, very sort of paper-based industry with not very well connected at all to a digital kind of system. And I think this is where I was going to ask my first question. So Josh encouraged me to do this. Yeah, so that's the question. Yeah, and okay. So two people, one for 50. Anyone else? No one for 10.
Is this per shipment or?
So this is one shipment of avocados, and actually someone sat with the container and followed it every step of the way from Kenya to Rotterdam and counted every single interaction that happened. And the question is, how many sort of information exchanges happened during that time? We done so. Okay, and of course the answer is 200, as most of you guessed. And so we, one of the big announcements from Maersk was that we're looking into to a blockchain initiative, Maersk and IBM together, setting up a completely independent joint venture that's looking to use blockchain to sort of digitize that paper trail. The transport and logistics sort of part of Maersk is all about sort of connecting and simplifying the supply chain, and I would say that customers probably would describe right now the supply chain as very complex and very disconnected. So what we're doing is we're trying to digitize the customer interactions, the assets that we have, and the paperwork that's used along the way. So this is the team in Maersk Digital. It's a team of around 15 data scientists. So part two, next interactive question, was how many nationalities we have on the team. And you can see we've got, I think it's 16 in total people. And I just wondered if you could guess. You can use your machine learning to figure out. Great, yeah. Excellent. It is, in fact, oops. It is, in fact, 10. So, so you can see roughly how we're organized and what our sort of various specializations are and the various nationalities that we're from. Basically, Barian is there. It's lonely at the top. He's sort of on his own as head of data science. We're specializing in areas like revenue optimization, asset science, forecasting, dynamic pricing, customer behavior, and we also have some research going on. So I'm going to talk about the journey of a banana and say how those things actually contribute to that journey, those particular areas. You can see that maybe you start off on your left, and the banana's grown on those nice trees over there. It enters a truck, it goes to a port, onto the vessel, and then it comes to Denmark or wherever. And so one of the things that we have to do is get the empty container to the customer. And believe it or not, Maersk spends a huge amount of money in the hundreds of millions actually just shipping empty containers around, because there's an asymmetry in the flow of containers. Goods travel, for example, from South America, where you have a banana, over to Europe, and you're left with the empty container and you have to get it back. And we've had some cases where containers have ping-ponged back and forth between locations and all sorts of things. So in this sort of case, data science is used for forecasting how many empties you're going to have, where you want to put them. And then on top of that, there's optimization in order to put them to the right place. So I think the last interactive question for tonight is how many bananas do you think you can fit in a 40-foot container? I think we're done. Okay, so most of people went high. Actually, it's the middle one this time. 100,000 bananas, which is quite a lot of bananas. So when we move them, we put them in these things called reefers, which are refrigerated containers. So actually, they're kept at usually around 15 degrees centigrade, and they transported. The journey from, say, South America to Europe takes 4 weeks on average. And they're kept at a steady temperature, and then that stops them from going ripe. When they get here, they're unpacked, and then they're ripened in they're unpacked in cold storage and then ripened, ready for the shop. And so these reefer containers, they have a GPS, a SIM card, an antennae, and they sort of give us our status information every hour and send that back to our systems, and then we can sort of monitor what's going on with the container. Various sensors sitting inside, measuring the supply temperature, and the return temperature, the pressure, CO2, things like that. And then what we're developing, has had its first release to customers, is a web app that lets customers see this data as it comes in, and that helps them to manage their supply chain. So here's an example of a banana, or a reefer with bananas in it. What's actually happening is that the bananas are packed in at temperature, at the ambient temperature, in say 30 degrees somewhere in Ecuador, for example, and then the door's shut and the temperature is pulled down to this constant temperature that I mentioned before, around 15 degrees C. What we're working with customers to do is actually use different statistical methods to identify anomalies and alert them when things go wrong with the container. So you see actually there's something goes wrong at the end of the journey here, but that doesn't actually affect the cargo in the end for this particular example. If it went wrong in the middle of the journey, then it would, and you can start to get an idea of how we've sort of teased out of the data, and there's more than just temperature, signals that would indicate that something is wrong with the cargo. So we get to the port now with the container, and the vessel is there. These huge cranes are going to move the container on and off the vessel. You can imagine if one of these cranes breaks down, then it's pretty bad news, right? Because they're huge things. They move along rails, just like a train. They have motors to move them along, and they lift them up and put them on and off. So we need to forecast ahead of time for the port what the sort of influx and outflux of containers are going to be. So forecasting again. Then we need to do, for example, predictive maintenance on the crane, because it's really, really important that these cranes are highly available. They move, it takes, on average, just over a minute to move a container on or off the vessel, which is quite incredible when you think about it. And then, of course, there's optimization to optimize where the containers sit and in the stack of containers in the yard. And there's a little example of some modeling that we did to predict the events. So those sort of yellow spikes are actual breakdown.